You remember those first raids, Kang said grimly. Bloody affairs for both sides. The dwarves suffered the most. With our experience and sheer size, we overpowered even the best dwarven warriors. Still, we were the ones at the disadvantage. When one of our warriors falls, he falls for good. There will be no replacements, ever. Before the War of the Lance, the evil clerics of Tarkesis had developed the arcane art of perverting good dragon eggs, changing the unborn baby dragon into a host of monstrous beings. Using various magics and sorceries, the evil clerics produced the warrior race which the armies of Tarkesis sorely needed, the Draconians. The dragon-spawned Draconians proved to be so powerful in their strength, intelligence, and cunning that their creators feared them. Lord Ariakas decided that the commanders could control the Draconians only if they could control their numbers. He and the other dragon high lords forbade the making of females. The Draconians could never breed. Presumably, when the battle was over and the Dark Queen victorious, she would no longer need the Draconians, and by that time, most of them would be dead. I watched our people die off in battle with the dwarves, Kang said, and I knew that over time we would be a people no longer. We would cease to exist. Of course, we could have wiped out the hill dwarves. But then what? Who would tend the fields of wheat? Who would raise the sheep? Who would... Kang ran his tongue over his fangs. Distill that concoction of the gods known as dwarf spirits. We'd starve to death. What's worse, we'd die of thirst. The other troop commanders and I came up with a possible solution. On our next raid, I ordered all weapons left behind. You know what happened. We grabbed the same number of loaves of bread, snatched up the same amount of chickens, and most important, we made off with the same quantity of dwarf spirits as the first raid. But our losses were considerably less. We fought our way in and out using fists and tails and a little magic. No one died on either side. And I'm pleased to note, when the hill dwarves raided us a month later, they carried no weapons. Thus, a tradition was born. It's become an unspoken covenant between the two settlements. I know it's frustrating, Kang. I know that you'd like nothing better than to rip off a dwarf's head and stuff it down his throat. I feel the same way, but we can't give him satisfaction. Understood? Then dismissed. Three cheers for the commander, Slith yelled. The troops cheered heartily enough. They respected and admired their leader. Kang had worked hard to gain their respect. But when all was said and done, what victory had the Draconians really won? Living behind a wall, fighting constantly to survive. And for what? All they lived for was to get drunk every night and tell the same blasted war stories over and over and over. Why do we even bother? Kang wondered morosely. He traipsed back alone to his cabin to indulge himself in his hangover. The four dwarves ran along a hunting trail that zigzagged through the tinted dry meadow grass. Three were wearing leather armor and heavy boots and sweating profusely. The fourth was clad in a velvet tunic, breeches, soft cloth and slippers that permitted him to move stealthily. The dwarves had done well for themselves in the raid that morning. One held a small lamb over his neck, grasping it by its legs. Two carried a large crate between them. The fourth dwarf carried nothing, which also accounted for the fact that he was enjoying the walk. One of the dwarves hefting the heavy, rattling crate noticed this singularity. Huffing and puffing from the heat and his exertion, the dwarf complained.
Hey, Selquist, what are we? You're pack horses. Come here and give us a hand. Now, Mortar, replied the dwarf, you know that I have a bad back. I know you can crawl through windows without any trouble, Mortar grumbled. And you can move pretty fast when you have to, like when that Draconian came at us with the club. I never see you hobbling around or crippled up.
Any well-traveled person on the Ensalon could have told at a glance that these were hill dwarves, as opposed to their cousins, the mountain dwarves. At least, the traveled person could have said that about three of the dwarves. They had nondescript brown hair, light brown skin, and the ruddy cheeks that come of being raised up from childhood on the healthful properties of nut ale. The fourth dwarf, whose name was Selquist, might have given the traveler pause. He appeared to fit into no specific category. His clothes were similar to those of his fellows, a shade less tidy, perhaps. This dwarf youngish, considered mean among his stout fellows, was quite good at performing at least one trick, making other people's personal possessions disappear. Besides, Auger, my friend, Selquist added, I, too, am carrying something, a most valuable treasure. If my hands aren't free, how will I defend it in case we're attacked? What is it? Mortar demanded. Selquist exhibited with pride an amulet he wore around his neck.
Big deal, said Pestle, Mortar's brother. A penny on a chain, but it's fool's gold.
It is not, Selquist returned indignantly.
The amulet was made of metal, but it wasn't a coin, at least not like any coin Selquist had seen. And he'd seen quite a few in his lifetime. It was shaped like a pentagram. Each point of the pentagram had a dragon's head inside it. The five-headed dragon identified it as a relic of the Dark Queen, making it worth quite a bit to those who traded in souvenirs from the War of the Lands. He had found the amulet while rummaging around in the Draconian's footlocker. In fact, he said to himself, it would be worth a whole lot more if it turned out to be magic. At that, a rather unpleasant thought occurred to Selquist. Hastily, he snatched off the amulet and thrust it into the money pouch hanging from his belt. The last thing I need is to be cursed by the Dark Queen for appropriating her jewelry, he muttered. I'll pass that along as an extra benefit to the buyer. The four crossed over a low ridge and were at last able to slow their pace. The main body of raiders had already returned, battered and bruised, but in good spirits. The entire population of the village of Celebunden was gathered at the meeting hall to greet the returning heroes. These four were missing the celebration, but that didn't bother them. They wouldn't have been included anyway. In fact, there were those in the village who would have celebrated if these four hadn't come back. Selquist and his party headed for Selquist's house, located on the outskirts of the village. Selquist unlocked the three locks on the door. He was of a suspicious nature, and entered. His three assistants clomped in behind him. Dumping the crate on the floor, they examined the contents. Shovels, said Selquist, peering down. Also, picks and a saw. Come now, he added, when he saw them scowl in disappointment. You didn't really expect we'd find a king's ransom stashed in a draconian shed. Those scaly louts wouldn't be hanging around this godforsaken valley if they had any money. What are they doing here? Pestle demanded. He was in a bad mood.
They've come here to die, said Auger solemnly.
But the others laughed at him derisively and began hauling tools out of the crate, tools that the draconians had likely stolen from the dwarves in an earlier raid.
Not bad, Pestle said to his brother. We can sell these for 10 steel. They're Thorbardin made. Good quality.
Very little was manufactured in Celebunden. Most of the dwarves' weapons were either purchased, bartered, or stolen from their richer, safer, and bitterly resented cousins, the dwarves of the mighty underground fastness of Thorbardin.
We can sell them to the Thane, Selquist said.
Pestle raised an objection.
But someone's bound to recognize these and claim them. Then the Thane will make us give them back.
They looked to Selquist, who was the acknowledged brains of the group.
I've got it, he said after a moment's thoughtful pause.
We'll take that little pissy lamb and make a present of it to the High Thane's daughter. We'll look like heroes. After that, if there's any dispute, the High Thane will be bound to side with us.
The brothers considered this option and pronounced it feasible. Auger, on the other hand, was not so agreeable.
I don't want to give our supper away to the High Thane's little brat.
You should think less of your stomach, Selquist said in moral tones, and more of the cause. We need all the money we can raise for our little expedition.
Auger knew all about the cause. The only cause Selquist ever promoted was Selquist. The meeting house was filled with dwarves, standing room only. Selquist, his friends, and the lambs squeezed their way through the entrance in the back and pushed forward toward the High Thane. After they presented the lamb, Selquist and company made their way back through the crowd, aiming for the huge keg of nut ale in one corner of the hall. Before they reached it, however, a hand caught hold of Selquist's tunic, giving it an expert twist. He was suddenly nose-to-nose with the grizzled, gray-haired, fierce war chief, the Seven.
Contrary to your opinion, Master Selquist, the war chief was red with fury, we do not run the raids on the draconian camp for the benefit of you and your thieving scamps. It's us who take the risks and buy rorks. I'm getting sick and tired of seeing your skinny butt disappear through a crack in the wall when my brave lads are getting their brains knocked out.
No great loss there, Selquist muttered.
What was that? The war chief dragged Selquist closer.
I said, you're the boss, Moorthane.
Selquist squirmed, trying to free himself.
The name is Moorthane, the war chief thundered. He gave Selquist a shake. Whatever you took, you bring to the High Thane to be distributed to those dwarves who are most needy, you dagger whelp.
Moorthane growled, emphasizing his words with an extra twist on the collar, which left Selquist momentarily speechless.
I don't ever want to see you on a raid again. If I do, I'll bring a motion to have you cast out.
The threat was a terrible one. A dwarf who is cast out is forever banished from his home and his clan. He becomes an exile, a wanderer over the face of the land. Moorthane dropped Selquist and stalked off. Selquist smiled at those dwarves standing nearby, who had been watching with stern approval. He straightened and smoothed his tunic. The other dwarves, glowering, turned their backs. He heard the word Darker repeated among them. But that was an old story, one in which he'd lost interest a long time ago. This threat to have him cast out, that was new. Admittedly, Moorbrain was mostly blubber and bluster. A motion to have Selquist cast out of his clan would require a unanimous vote of all the dwarfen heads of household. An unlikely occurrence, though few of them numbered Selquist as a friend, or even someone to whom they might stop to give a drink of water if he were dying of thirst in the desert. Selquist poured himself a large mug of nut ale and settled down to put Moorbrain out of his mind and enjoy himself. His three companions emerged from the thickest part of the crowd and came to join him. Upon the arrival of the war chief, they had blended in with the crowd, leaving their leader to his fate.
"Did I hear Moorthane threaten to have you cast out?"
Mortar demanded aghast.
"Bah!"
Selquist brushed it aside.
"He can try,
but he'll never get the votes. My mother will stick up for me, for one."
"Speaking of your mother, he called you a Darga,"
said Auger in a low voice. "Doesn't that bother you?"
"No,"
Selquist said lightly.
"Why should it? It's true, I'm half Darga. And I'm proud of my heritage. Ask anyone. They'll tell you that the Darga are the most feared of all dwarves. Noted across Ancelon for being powerful warriors.
The Darga, or Dark Dwarves, were also noted for being murderers and thieves. But Selquist's companions wisely refrained from pointing this out. The Celebundan Dwarves belonged to the Nidir clan of dwarves. After the Dwarfgate War, a war brought on by the refusal of the Hylar Dwarves to assist their kinsmen following the Cataclysm, the Nidir Dwarves were forever barred from the hallowed halls of Thorbardin. All that was ancient history. As for the Dargar, they had split off from the main clans in Thorbardin following an unsuccessful attempt to seize control from the Hylar. Delving even deeper into the labyrinthian caves of Thorbardin, the souls of the Dargar grew dark as their surroundings. Dargar are excellent thieves, and are known throughout the dwarfdom as the most dexterous and dishonest of all dwarves. Traits that Selquist had inherited. Selquist and Auger bid goodnight to the brothers Pestle and Mortar, and walked back to their own house. Arriving at home, he unlocked the three locks, entered, lit the lamp, and settled down to work. This meant that he lounged in the best chair, while Auger sat at the desk and wrote down Selquist's orders. Selquist liked to have his plans in writing. "We leave a week from tomorrow night," Selquist dictated. "It will be quiet, there's no raid planned, and there will be two full moons, making it easy to travel. We can cross Mount Celebund and be halfway to the South Gate by morning. The next day, we'll complete the journey and enter Thorbardin." Reading back over his notes, Auger discovered a serious flaw in the plan.
Selquist, how are we going to get into Thorbardin? I thought the Hylor wouldn't let us need our inside."
Selquist patted his friend on the back. "You leave that to me. I have a way in. Now get some sleep. We did a lot of work today." 8 days after the dwarven raid on the draconian village, Kang entered the command post's conference room. The six officers of his brigade were inside, ready and waiting. These included the 1st, 2nd, and support squadron commanders, as well as his chief engineer, chief supply officer, and Slith, his second. Kang greeted the officers. Then they quickly got down to business. They were planning a counterattack on the dwarven village. Both moons would be full tonight, ideal conditions for a raid. Kang issued his orders. The 2nd squadron was to move out 1 hour after sundown, and the 1st was to move out half an hour after them. The support squadron was to man the battlements for the duration. A brief discussion of strategy followed, and then Kang dismissed the officers and returned to his quarters. He always enjoyed this time, just before a raid. It took him back to the old days, back when being a soldier meant something, back when he could feel proud to command combat troops. If it weren't for the dwarves, the draconians would have had no excitement at all. In fact, Kang was forced to grudgingly admit, if it weren't for the dwarves, the draconians could not have survived this long. Not only did the dwarves provide much-needed food, they served as an outlet for the draconians' inborn aggression. The potent drink known as dwarf spirits, which was said to be made from some sort of fermented fungus, brightened, at least temporarily, the bleakness and emptiness of the draconians' daily lives. If it weren't for the dwarves, the draconians would have torn each other apart years ago. Kang was feeling almost brotherly toward his bewhiskered adversaries,